you've discovered Molly at the front desk. She will have a 1 minute, a 30 second, and then a stop sign to keep you. And we'll try to stick to that as best we can, just to keep this moving for the benefit of our audience. So let's jump right into this. Again, thank you to Debbie Kendrick from the Mark Twain Association of Realtors for working so hard on these questions, and we believe they're all relevant to all of us in the room and to the position to which you're running. So the Missouri State Senate is the upper chamber of the Missouri General Assembly, and it works alongside the governor and the House of Representatives to create laws and establish a state budget. The question is, what background do you have with budgetary formation and implementation, and what is your view of the most important issues concerning the state with regard to the budget? So with this question, we will go to Representative Redmond. And for the benefit of the audience, we will have the questions on the screen for you. Thank you, Representative.
Okay, here we go. The background I have, as I mentioned in my beginning, is being a small business owner. And if you don't have a budget to stick to a budget as a small business owner, you're not gonna make any money, and you're not gonna be able to feed your family. Now, I've been on the State Budget Committee for the last 6 years. I've been in appropriations for 8 years, and I was the chairman of those committees that I mentioned, budget for 6 years, and the last three for 2 years. So not only have I formed a budget, I've had to set on the opposite side of the table, because in Missouri we have a great thing called the balanced budget amendment. Our amendment, our budget has to balance at the end of the year. So that means there's a lot of good programs out there that we have to say no to. And that's not easy, but it has to be done. And at the end of the day, our state's better because of it. So my experience has been strictly on the budget committee for the state. I've done that. I feel like I understand it, have a good grasp of it, and would like to take that forward.
And I beat her on her side. And we get extra points for that.
You did. So next we will go to Representative Walker.
Thank you. I think it's really important that we have a fiscal responsible government. And in the state of Missouri, as Craig indicated, we have a balanced budget amendment, and that's very important. Our budget in the state of Missouri is around $28.3 billion. When I served in the legislature back in the 80s, that budget was about $8 billion. I served on the Appropriations Committee back during that time. Now I'm the chairman of the State House Pensions Committee. And we know that pensions are very important, that we have to make sure that we do everything to keep them strong. But being a businessman, owning a newspaper, a farmer, I understand how the need to make sure that your budgets are balanced, and it's important that we have good fiscal responsible conservatives there. I have a record to prove that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Aren't they doing great with this timing thing? Molly's not having to do her job. So now we'll move to Representative Shoemaker on the budget question.
One thing that's unique about Missouri and our budget is that, in our financial state in general, is that we are a AAA bond rated state, and we're one of the very few. Last I knew, we were one of seven. It's a constitutional requirement. There's three things we have to do in keeping with the Constitution. One is in any one given session, and one is an address, state of the state by the governor, state of the judiciary by the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and a budget. So yes, our budget is $28 billion. When I first started, it was $24 billion. General revenue now is $10 billion of that, and before it was $8 billion. With all the tax cutting that we've done, we've managed to still have more money come into the coffers. One of the biggest challenges in our budget is Medicaid. That's the biggest item. And right behind that item, Medicaid is money for schools. And we give $3.4 billion to K through 12 education, which is the most that we've given at any time. It's fully funding the foundation formula. And there's a lot of other line items beside that too. and it's a very complicated thing. All of us vote on it. Only 35 out of 163 of us are actually directly involved with the budget. I think that's the number that's on the budget committee, but the rest of us have to stay tuned and know what it's all about also. Thank you.
Thank you. So now we'll move on to the next question that is also related to the budget. And that is, all three of you were members of the House of Representatives, obviously this year. And in April, I understand the House of Representatives passed House Bill 2540, which would reduce the corporate and top individual income tax rates to 5% and raise State Department of Motor Vehicle fees. The question is, what is your opinion of the corporate tax rate, and how do you feel this affects the 18th district? And thank you for understanding the order, Representative Walker.
Thank you.
We're getting in a groove here.
I went to a one-room schoolhouse, so yeah. I was taught to know how to get in line and do things right. I supported that legislation, and I think it's very important that we have a balanced budget in the state of Missouri, and that we also make sure that we don't bring in more revenue than we need. Ronald Reagan, who's one of my heroes in politics, always talked about, the government really doesn't have a tax problem, they have a problem of spending. And so in the state of Missouri, I think the balanced budget to say does quite a bit. But I think the corporate tax cut that we had was responsive. And also I think raising some fees to make sure that we have some additional funding for other things like transportation was responsible. And if this tax plan doesn't work the way we think it will, then I'll be open as a state senator to look at revising it. But I think it was a good step in the right direction. It took a lot of compromise, took a lot of work by both the House and the Senate, and I think it's good, and I supported it. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Shumate.
For many, many years, our individual income tax rate was 6%, and a bill that had been passed a few years ago phased in a individual tax cut that would take it down to 5.5% in certain successions, depending on how much money comes in that serve as triggers. This latest bill would, in final analysis, when all that's done, would take the individual tax down to 5.1%. That's the tax that we all pay that have earned income. The corporate income tax goes from 6.25% to 4%. I think it's good because they think, well, what are you doing? You're letting corporations off the hook and giving them something. Well, corporations are people too. Corporations invest in business. People, if you have a 401k plan, your money is invested probably in a corporation. If that corporation gets a break, you do too. If the corporation can buy more equipment, that stimulates the economy. If the corporation can give more income to its workers, then that helps us all. And so I don't look at tax policy zero income being zero, but it also, there's a dynamic effect that helps the economy in general and also helps the individual's taxpayer out there. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Redman.
I also supported this legislation. About 3 years ago, we had our first income tax cut that we passed, and before that, it had been 100 years in our history that we've done an income tax cut. And now, with this last session, we've done two within the last 3 years. I'm a firm believer that the public can spend their money better than the government can. It's very important for them to get out there and spend, and our economy will grow. I think everything is based off our economy. Whether we have money for schools, roads, healthcare, it all depends on how our private sector is doing. And this tax cut and the corporate tax cut definitely will help spur that along. I think we can look just up the road a few miles here and look at Dole Manufacturing. It's moved over from Illinois. Illinois' corporate tax rates are driving more and more business. The 18th district is positioned perfectly to assimilate a lot of these businesses, and hopefully a little bit later on, we'll see some of the areas that we're low in. Hopefully with our economy growing, this will be a factor that will help improve those. So I support this. I always support giving money back to the people. I hate to pay taxes as bad as anybody. So even though I have to sit on the other side of the table and pay a lot of these bills on the budget committee, we'll figure it out. As long as you guys have the money, we actually see, and it's been proven, that your economy and your revenues at the state will grow if people have more money to spend.
Thank you. So in the next round, Representative Shoemake will go first. And this question, noting that state workers in Missouri are among the lowest paid public employees in the country, what is your opinion of the pay for performance study being discussed for state worker compensation, and can we afford those potential pay increases?
First of all, I do believe that it can be true that state worker like 50 out of 50, so you can't be worse than that. I'm a volunteer in corrections, and I used to be a state worker myself for 20 years, and I know how state workers think. For example, up here in the prison that's in Bowling Green, they're talking about shutting down a house or two there because they're like at 60% staff. It concerns me greatly that these particularly prison correctional officers aren't being paid as well as they should. I think we have to take a serious look about this because security is becoming a problem. We want to retain good workers and state workers. We want to be good workers and we want safety. If there's a competing job out there with less stress, then some of those correctional officers are taking those jobs and putting our prisons in the position that they're in. I do believe that they deserve better. I think also that if they were paid better, that there has to be a continual turnover in prison guards too, because and there has to be retraining. They're always training new and more, and so that money could be plowed into raises rather than lost.
Thank you, Representative Redman.
Thank you. I support the performance base versus just if you've worked there a year, you automatically get something. That's a way that you don't always keep your best worker, is if you just automatically give them a raise every year versus performance based. The key is finding the performance factors that you need to measure. I know from owning and operating my own businesses, it's much cheaper to give out raises periodically than retrain new employees. I mean, that's a proven fact. So we have to look at that so that we actually save the state money in the long run. Since I've sat on the budget committee, we've actually had two raises, not big raises, but some form of raises. And we've worked very diligently to get those to what we call the boots on the ground people that make $50,000 or less, because it's very easy in government to become top-heavy, and those people at the top get a lot more money than the people that are down there doing the work. So I think if we do go to performance-based raises, I'm very much in favor of that, but we have to have some good performance-based factors and matrix to use as we're doing that.
Very good, thank you. And finally, on the state worker pay question,
thank you. I think it's real important that we do have a good criteria, performance-based criteria to evaluate our state employees. But I do think we also have to make sure that we have the compensation plans that will attract good employees to come into the state. Representative Shoemake talks about our correction officers. Our correction officers are being paid very lowly. And we need to make sure that we have a compensation plan that rewards those who do well, and those who do not do well, we can get rid of them. And so we've also passed some legislation this year to revise the merit system in state government. But I think it's important that we need to go out and recruit good workers to be able to compensate them fairly and in a way that keeps them there, because it is very expensive to retrain others. Thank you.
Thank you. So Debbie had talked to us about having an open question at the end of each section, but I was wondering if you're okay with it, Since we've talked a lot about the budget, maybe we move on to education. Is that okay with everyone? And
you've got the microphone.
And then, audience, remember that if any of you have questions, get those to the table down front. So we're going to move on to from the open statement to questions about education. And the first question will be, since the Missouri, workforce retention and recruitment, what are your legislative goals to improve the culture of change and employment engagement in the 18th district and the state of Missouri as a whole?
Okay. First of all, I'm a little bit about education. Everything that I know about education came from my experience sitting on the Canton School Board. I was there for 9 years, just a member for three, and got reelected vice president, then ran again and got reelected and served 3 years president. So everything that deals with education with me kind of comes from that. I think as far as what we're doing for our workforce, I think we've woken up a little bit in the state of Missouri and realized that not everybody needs a four-year education. We need to do certificates for 2 years for some vocational. We need to have welders and carpenters and other skilled technicians out there. One thing that we are doing right now is our community colleges are doing a phenomenal job in workforce development. They are actually partnering with businesses and adapting programs specifically for these businesses. And a lot of these businesses are paying the tuitions of the people that are going to these colleges to learn this. So I think that is probably the best thing that we can do and expand on that moving forward. The job market and job world out there is changing so fast that today's job in 10 years may not even exist. And we've got to have the fluidity and the ability to train people so that they, what they're doing today may be passe and old, and get them ready for the next phase and what these businesses that want to move into our area. Because that's one of the first things that businesses are going to look for is, do you have an adequately trained workforce to fill our position? So I think we're on the right track with that, and I think that keeping our community colleges are in the right direction.
Very good. Thank you. Representative Walker.
Well, I think any education is good for anybody. And my two sons, I've always told them that the more education they can get, the better chances their life will be to be successful. It doesn't make you successful. But we have to look at different models, and we have to make sure, and I've encouraged them to look towards an area that they want to do, what they want to do in life, and to find something that they're happy with and it doesn't seem like a work job. In the state of Missouri, we've made some great inroads. Our community colleges are really coming forward, and our career centers and our high schools train vocational, and our career centers are doing a good job, and then our universities are doing a good job. So we have to really support our higher education and our high schools and our career centers. But it's very, very important to be able to have workforce development. In Kirksville, we had a big expansion at the Hines Craft Place, and the Mobile Area Community College came in with the Career Center and helped them out to get those jobs people trained. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think one of the biggest problems throughout the rural area in Northeast Missouri is getting our young people to stay here, giving them a reason to stay here and to continue to live here after their education, or to go and get their education and come back here and have their careers. So many of our young like to go out to someplace else, another state, big cities and so forth, where they feel there's more opportunity, but somehow they need to be convinced that those opportunities do in fact exist here. When I was young, we had the Distributive Education Clubs of America. I understand this high schools still have that. One thing that can be done is partnerships with educational institutions and local businesses. A lot of these things are things that have to be just handled through cooperative efforts down on the local level. They don't require any legislation or any, I don't believe that legislation is always the answer to food problems, but we also have to change the culture, and we have to change the mindset of our young folks into everybody's got to have a college education where that it's perfectly okay to take up a vocational trade. In fact, there's more need for that. And the other thing, in stopping, I'll just have to save it for next time.
Sticking with this education theme, let's get very specific on charter school expansion. That was proposed in various bills in the most recent legislative session, House Bill 2247 and Senate Bill 612, and I understand the National Education Association opposed both those measures. What is your opinion of charter schools within the 18th district? And with this one, we'll start with Representative Walker.
Well, that's one question that I think most of you know where I stand on. I've been opposed to charter schools in rural Missouri. I think in our rural schools here in the 18th Senatorial District, we have good schools run by local school board members. They hire good administrators, and the administrators are good teachers. Throughout my district, my house district, I have children that grow to school, they graduate, they go to Yale, they go to the Naval Academy, they go to various places of higher education. So I'm against charter schools. I do think that charter schools may work some places in the suburbs and maybe in the cities, but out here in the rural areas, we do not need charter schools. We need to continue to have a strong local control of our schools, and I will be one of the adamant opponents to charter schools if elected. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Schumann, charter schools.
What a lot of people don't realize about charter schools is that a charter school is a public school. It's a different form of a public school. And they've been used to solve problems in the urban areas, problems that resulted in the unaccreditation of those school districts. And the charter schools came in and are there now. I understand, I think there are five that are on tap to be chartered this year. They offer distinct programs. I think it's time for innovative type programs. Now, out here in the 18th district, and the legislation that was proposed is very likely to affect any place in the 18th district. Having a charter school, I mean, any school district can have one if they want one. They don't have to have a problem to do that. But if a school building fell below their rating and was in trouble academically, then a charter school could be established. That's the way that it was. I did a poll in my own district right here in the unscientific, but I believe the results are comparable to scientific polls. 54% wanted school choice, 38% thought that it was okay the way that it is, and 8% didn't know what to think. I'd like to read just one thing later.
There'll be more time on an education wrap-up, Representative.
Thank you. The way these bills were presented when they came up a couple of years, they didn't come up this year, but the year before, school had to score 60 or below on their APR. In the 18th Senatorial District, there was only one school building that I think actually had 60 or below. That was in Hannibal. So charter schools would not really be a factor in the 18th Senatorial District. Now, one thing I'm gonna say, I'm not for charter schools, but I am for educating our children. And I want the best education, whether it be in Palmyra or whether it be down in the middle of St. Louis. And for some reason or other, we've got this one size fits all for education in the state of Missouri, and we've gotta get out of that mindset, because what works here and what's working here is working very well. So I'm gonna protect our schools and fight tooth and nail to keep them like this. But I also want a good education for those kids down in the inner city. And somehow we're gonna have to get past this, well, if we do it here, it's gotta be done exactly like that down there. So there's a lot of room to think about charter schools, but personally, charter schools in the 18th Senatorial District is not really feasible. There's no need for them. We have great schools. we need to take the money that we're spending on education and keep spending it on the schools we have. I mean, they've got needs and things that they can do better, and until we've got them at perfect, then we need to concentrate on the schools that are there. Thank you.
Thank you. One more specific question on education, and then we'll get to the questions, the first question from the audience. This next question, we'll get back to our 1-2-3 order. Representative Shoemaker will go first. Education received an increase in the 2019 budget for the state of Missouri. Is the funding formula the best solution for the school districts within the 18th district? And if not, do you have a better answer for the funding formula for schools?
Well, I'm satisfied with the foundation formula as it functions right now. And we did do a tweak to that since I've been state representative. I think my colleagues are also there too. And for now 2 sessions, we've been able to fully fund the formula. And K-12 education out of about $10 billion in general revenue gets $3.4 billion. The Constitution requires 25%, that's a lot more than 25%. Now, there was a component in that formula called the state adequacy target, and after the formula was changed, it made it a moving target, and it was really hard to hit, so we kind of went back to the way it was originally. I think the formula, the way it is right now, is fair. It's hard to come up with a perfect way of funding schools, but I think that the components in it, it's a 4-part formula, weighted average, state adequacy target, the dollar value modifier, and local effort. I think that's going to mean plenty to talk to you, a lot of you, but it's a very complicated formula, but I believe it's also very fair, and I don't see at this point where it needs to be changed.
Thank you. Representative Redmond, the school funding formula.
I'm going to say I like it, and don't anybody ask me to explain it, because I've actually sat through a class where they tried to explain it, and when I got done, my head was spinning. But as I mentioned earlier, my background, coming from a school board of a small school, the foundation formula, I feel like, does the best job that it possibly can. One of the main reasons I don't want to tweak it is because right now, if you would take my district and overlay it over the St. Louis area, you would have one representative there versus 49 down in the St. Louis area, in the urban area. And if you've got that, those people are going to be looking out for their areas. And if that formula gets changed, I guarantee you it's not going to be changed for the better for us. So I think that it's one of those things. Is it perfect? No. Is it something we can live with? Definitely. I'm extremely proud of the fact that we've funded the foundation formula for the second year in a row. That's never happened in our history before. We worked real hard on the budget committee to get that money put back in there and not to hurt nursing homes in the process, because they need their money as much as the schools do. So it was a tough year, but it was a good year on the budget, and I'm very proud and was eager to get my car and drive back and tell all my school people that we had funded the formula again. So is it perfect? No. Is it pretty darn good for our needs? Yes, and I think we should keep it, because what we might get might be a lot worse than what we have right now.
Representative. I support the school foundation formula system the way it is. I think it works well. The reason why it works well is because we've had input and participation from school administrators, from not only the urban schools, but from the rural schools. And legislators have listened to them to come up with a plan that meets all the needs of the children. In my district, I meet with my school administrators once a month. We meet, have a little lunch, and we talk for about 2 hours or so. I think it's real important that we get the input of the people that our different programs impact. And so the school foundation formula right now, as Craig said, when you overlap our districts, we go against 35 or 40 or more representatives in the urban areas. But I think it's real important that we continue to work hard for public education, and the school foundation formula works well, and we're going to keep it that way. Thank you.
Very good. So let's move to a question that will not be on the screen because this is coming from the audience. And we will, let me read the question and then we can talk about the order. What will you do to protect marriage and religious liberty? So yes, Representative Redmond, you can go first. Okay. What will you do to protect marriage and religious liberty is the question from the audience.
I believe in the sanctity of marriage. I believe it's between a man and a woman. I will stand up and fight against anyone that says any different. I think that we live in a society now that people don't want equal, they want more for certain things. I think this is an area they don't want equal rights, they want more rights. So my stance would be to protect the sanctity of marriage as it's laid out in the law.
Thank you. Representative Walker, what will you do to protect marriage and religious liberty?
I'll continue to do the same things that I've been doing over the last several years. I believe that that a marriage should be between a man and a woman. We have a constitutional provision right now that is a little different than that. I'm a constitutional conservative, so I'm not going to go against the Constitution, but I think it's very important that everybody has religious rights and that we respect all people's opinions. And so I will do everything I possibly can to protect the sanctimony of marriage and religious rights. And I think that's real important. Thank you.
Representative Shoemake, the final on what will you do to protect marriage and religious liberty?
My wife and I, as of the other day, were married 43 years. And I also believe in the sanctity of marriage. I believe it's between one man and one woman. And also, I think there's some things we can do. In my first term, in the interim, we have what we call interim committees. I asked the speaker to have I wanted to have a committee about strengthening Missouri marriages in Missouri. That's what I wanted it to be. They thought that was too narrow, so we went around the state talking about various things, and we ended up talking about everything what I really wanted to talk about. I think one of the biggest things, biggest problems here is the divorce rate, and families not forming in the first place. And I think it's time to happen all over the United States to end no-fault divorce. I don't think there should be such a thing, but now all 50 states have it. And I think it's time to end that, and also end any welfare-type programs too that discourage marriage and responsibility. The TANF plan was supposed to encourage a two-parent family. Some people don't even realize that was one of the goals in the federal TANF program. But we really have a problem, and a lot of the problems that we have in education and everywhere else is because of the breakdown of the family. And I think we can do only so much as legislators. Beyond that, it's up to the clergy, and it's up to going back to those basic values that I believe that we should all hold to be true. Thank you.
We are now going to move on to medical marijuana. With medical marijuana being legalized in some form in 30 states and in Washington, D.C., there's a House bill that's been introduced in Missouri, House Bill 1554, that would allow medical marijuana to be available to eligible patients with terminal illness, including but not limited to cancer, glaucoma, HIV, ALS, and epilepsy. Patients would be authorized to possess up to 20 ounces of smokeless medical marijuana. Preventing an eligible patient from accessing medical marijuana would be a Class A misdemeanor. What is your opinion of House Bill 1554 and medical marijuana being legalized? And with this one, we'll start with Representative Walker.
I supported the legislation. This bill was brought to us by Dr. Neely, Representative Neely from Cameron. It is a smokeless marijuana bill, but it is generated to work on chronic pain, chronic illness, and I think it's just another form of how that we can deal with it. I was on a forum in my district about 3 or 4 years ago, and there were about 250 people there, and most of the people there that were in support of it were veterans and people who had chronic pain. And when you get to be a certain age, you start having pain. I don't use marijuana, but if it was something that would make my life and quality of life better, I would. But I'm getting to the age where every morning I wake up with a few aches and pains and so forth. But particularly in those instances where this is a better source than opioids or other sort of things. So I did support the bill. I think it eventually will be a law in Missouri. Thank you.
Representative Schumann on medical marijuana being legalized.
We had a hemp bill that had to do with CBD oil, that the extract can be used to help children with epilepsy, and I didn't have too much problem with that because the substance can't be used to get one high. But I really do have a problem with medical marijuana, and I don't doubt the intentions of my colleagues in promoting it. When you see somebody go through pain and so forth, you try to think of any way you can to relieve that pain. I grew up in the 60s, and if I could put all of the good that I've seen that has come forth from the use of marijuana on one side of the scale and put all the bad on another side of the scale, it would tip to the bad. I've seen a whole lot more bad things come from the use of marijuana than good things. And I believe that there are other medications out there. I believe that the goal of those that are promoting this for just the dying is really full legalization, like Colorado would have, and taxing and selling and all of that. So for that reason, I think it's the camel's nose under the tent. I did not support it and will not support it.
Representative Redmond, House Bill 1554 and legalization of medical marijuana.
Yes, I supported this also. I know Dr. Neely, I'm a friend of Dr. Neely's, and I trust his opinion. The key word here for me was end of life. It's not for anything other than that. You have to have one of these diseases and you have to be terminally ill with those diseases to use it. I trusted Dr. Neely's opinion on this because he's a doctor. Also, I believe Dr. Frederick, the other doctor in the House, supported it also. So because of those two factors, I did. I do agree with Representative Schumann. We have to be extremely careful that this isn't camel's nose under the tent. I think we can just look at Colorado and see that just marijuana as an open sale is not right for Missouri, because of all the bad things that come with it. But when I'm at the end of my life and I need something to relieve my pain, I'm hoping that it's available out there, and I'm hoping that if someone else is out there, I'm not the person that's saying, no, you can't have this. And that's why I support it.
Thank you. We're now gonna move to a round of questions on economic development, and after this round, we'll move to the second question from our audience. This section is important to me. I'm fortunate enough to serve as vice chairman of the Hawthorne Foundation for the state of Missouri, and we're very focused on promoting the state to the world, and I spend a lot of time doing that. In addition to the Hawthorne Foundation and Missouri Partnership and the Department of Economic Development here in the state, we also have the Missouri Career Center, the Missouri Economic Development Council, Missouri Entrepreneurship and Business Development Center, and the Northeast Missouri Workforce Investment Board, just to name a few. And I think this is something that's important to all of us. What are you, we're gonna go back to our 1-2-3 now. So this will be Representative Schumann, followed by Representative Redmond, and finally Representative Walker. The question for you, Representative Schumann, first,
what are the greatest assets of the 18th district and what are the weakest points of the 18th district under the guise of economic development?
A long list here. I believe our people, rich cultural heritage, churches, religious institutions, schools, colleges, universities, natural resources, land, the diversity of our agricultural operations in the 18th district, medical care, we've got a lot of good medical care here, tourism, manufacturing operations, highway infrastructure, right here in Hannibal, we sit crossing two major highways, and one big one that sometimes we forget, the Mississippi River. I've gone out to Washington, D.C. I've been to some conferences. I'm on a committee, a conference of legislators regarding the Mississippi River. Went out to Washington, D.C. here recently, talking about issues pertaining to the Mississippi River and the 10 states that surround the Mississippi River. We have a great asset here that's been developed somewhat in the past, but there's a lot more developing that could be done for the river and some upgrades also at the same time. And the 18th district has got the Mississippi River as our border on the eastern edge. And I think we should look at international trade, things like this, directly from our area, and things like this regarding the Mississippi River. So we have a lot of things. I guess I didn't get to the challenges.
Thank you, Representative Shoemaker. Representative Redmond, under the guise of economic development, our greatest assets and weakest points.
Sure. It, as Lyndall said, you know, I believe our greatest assets are our work ethic for our people. We have people that know how to get up and go to work at the crack of dawn, and they work all day, and they work hard, and they quit when the sun goes down. And the next day, they do the same thing. And that's been instilled in us. So we have that work ethic and that drive. We have a great educational system in this area. 18th district, all the schools do a good job. I've said out of my district in the 4th House district, but I'll say it about the Senate district also, that it wouldn't bother me to send my kids to any school in this district. They're all good schools, so we have a good education. Some of the weakest points right now are infrastructure. It needs attention. We all know our roads are crumbling, but it's also one of our strongest. I've served as vice chairman of ports for 2 years. We've got that river out there that we can get our products to market cheaper than anybody else. We can get them all over the world. So we need to take advantage of that, you know, to keep our farms and farmers going great guns. They do a great job of producing products. We need to keep products, places for those products to sell. So our weakness is also our strength. We need to look at how we're going to improve our roads. We have trains, we have four-lane highways. We have a tremendous potential here, but our people are our best potential. And because of that, I think we've got a bright future ahead of us.
And finally, Representative Walker, on economic development and our assets and weak points.
Well, first of all, thank you for your service to the Hawthorne Foundation, because I think without the Hawthorne Foundation, starting way back, but when Governor Kip Bond was governor, he really made that work well for the whole state of Missouri, and I think Governor Parsons will continue that tradition. But we have to take the resources that we have and do the best we can with them, and I think both Representative Shoemaker and Representative Redmond have covered lots of those topics. I think our workforce is uniquely made for here. Most of the people in Northeast Missouri have the common sense approach. They get up every morning, they want to work and that sort of thing. And so we have a productive workforce. I think one of the things that we have to continue to look towards is infrastructure development, not just with our roads, but with some of our small towns, with their water and sewer districts. And that's why Representative Redmond and I and Representative Shoemaker have supported water projects here in Northeast Missouri. And I think we just have to continue to work towards making sure that we have a good, strong salesperson as the state senator in the 18th district. I could be that salesperson, and I look forward to doing it. So, thank you.
Very good.
So I think we've covered general economic development enough, but agriculture is incredibly important to the state of Missouri as an economic development driver. So Senator Ron Richard was quoted as saying that Senator Brian Munslinger may be the best agriculture committee chair in Missouri history. With this one, we will begin with Representative Redman. What is your agriculture background, and how do you intend to keep the 18th district covered in the agribusiness legislation?
Well, my agriculture background started real early. We weren't born or wasn't raised on a farm, but my mom had this crazy thing that she wanted me working every minute of the day that the sun was up. So she would call a farmer or two and make sure that I was either bucking bales or chopping weeds or something my entire youth, and it made her happy, and it was good for me too. So I grew up working on farms. Then when I graduated high school, I went to college, and for 2 years I worked on a Mormon research farm where we worked with cattle. Learned quite a bit about that, and then came back, and if you live in this area, then you know about agriculture. So we live on a small farm right now. We actually have a cash rented out. But speaking a little bit about Brian Munslinger, Brian, of course, is Ag Chairman over in the Senate, and I'm Agriculture Appropriations Chairman over in the House. So we kind of have a funny little saying back and forth that he dreams up all this stuff, and then I have to figure out how to pay for it. And that's kind of how we've done. And over the last 6 years, we've worked hand in hand together. I feel like we've developed a great relationship. He's been a tremendous mentor to me, and Senator Munslinger came out and endorsed my candidacy for the Senate. So I was very honored and humbled that he did that. Brian has worked tirelessly for agriculture in outstate Missouri. He's left big shoes to fill, but I feel with his tutorage and with the knowledge I've gained, I can do that job.
Representative Walker.
Certainly the leader in agriculture in the state of Missouri in the General Assembly has been Brian Munslinger. Senator Munslinger served in the House for 8 years and now 8 years in the Senate. Senator Munslinger and I have a lot in common. We both are graduates of the School of Agriculture from the University of Missouri. We were both born and raised on a farm. Both of my grandparents were fathers were farmers, and my dad was a farmer, my brother's a farmer, and I'm a farmer. And like Craig said, when you grow up on a farm or you grow up in a rural area, you go early in the morning and you come down when the sun comes down. But certainly agriculture is a very important part of the 18th district. I had the opportunity to drive through Shelby County, Knox County, and some of the other areas and see the corn growing and the beans and everything else. But as a farmer, I will be committed, and I'm going to ask to be placed as the chairman of the Agriculture Committee if elected to the 18th District Senate. Thank you very much.
Finally.
Well, formerly, I also served on the Agriculture Committee. As far as background, I don't have a background being a farmer, but I did buck some bales, and that was the hardest work, I think, physical work that I've ever done. And you ache in every part of your body. It's very hard work. But every one of us who eat three times a day are interested in agriculture. And we have to learn things that we maybe didn't grow up with. We had a garden when I grew up, and generations before me had farms. And what I've come to learn about, that one of the biggest challenges in farming now is retaining farmers. That I forgot if it's the median or the average age of the farmer, but it's about 57 years old, and it's going up. Agriculture is like anything else. We have to interest the next generation of farming and to get started in what is a very expensive business and increasingly scientific type business, and where there's a lot of capital involved. And we have, in order to maintain our position as the in farming and making it our number one industry in the state, I think we have to do this. I think we've looked at value added things in crops like corn and ethanol, and there are other value added things that can be done to increase the value of farm products.
Representative Walker.
Thank you. Not getting totally away from economic development, but also combining the budget that we've talked about. We have several questions from the audience, and this one combines several things, and it's related to transportation, which obviously is important for economic development, but it's a big budget issue as well. All of you supported tax cuts. Where do you feel support for improvement of roads should come from? And with this one, we'll start with Representative Walker. So a question from the audience about roads and how to pay for them.
We have a proposal that will be on the November ballot. I think all three of us supported it, but I know I did in particular. It's a 10-cent sales tax, or 10-cent gas tax that will be earmarked for law enforcement, 2.5 cents over 4 years. That will be able to generate around $300 million. Right now, the road tax money that we generate from usage tax has to pay for law enforcement, the highway patrol, and so we're going to take this opportunity to give the voters the opportunity to pay for, or to vote and support this. Wherever I travel throughout the 3rd District or even the 18th District, people are talking about the farm to market roads. There's a safety situation there, and then most of our farmers have semi-trucks, and most of us have to almost drive down the center of the road just to get, because our roads are crumbling and that sort of thing. So our farm to market roads are in need, and so I support this, and I think you'll be pleased to know that Governor Parsons is stepping out to support this, because he understands the infrastructure needs for rural Missouri and for all the whole state in general. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Shoemake will be next on transportation. How are we going to pay for road improvements?
Well, I've become convinced over the last few years that the Department of Transportation does need more money in order to take care of our roads and bridges. And with this, your vote is going to count as much as any of ours because of the fact we have a thing called the Hancock Amendment that we can't unilaterally impose taxes upon the population. And I think about a penny is about all we could do as a legislature without going to a vote of the people. The gas tax right now is 17 cents per gallon, and it's been that way for about 20 years or so. And we know that because of inflation and the cost of living index and so forth, that 17 cents doesn't go as far as it used to, but it's the same. We also have, as it was a couple of decades ago. And prices have gone up to maintain those roads and bridges, and the amount of revenue hasn't kept up with the increase in material that's necessary to do it. And so the answer to that question is in the hands of the voter now. And with that, the 10 cents chain will go to the Department of Public Safety to fund theirs, but the whole 17 cents then, the way I understand it, will go to fund our roads and bridges.
Thank you, Mr. President.
I supported this. I voted for it when it came to the House floor for a couple of reasons. One, it does go to vote of the people in November, so you guys will be the ultimate judges on this, and I feel that's very important with this size of an increase. The one other reason that I support it, it's a user tax. It's a tax that would have been placed on gasoline, people that are going to use the roads. Being 100% honest, I'm uncomfortable with the way that it's being handled. It is actually taking highway patrol money out and just supplanting it with this, kind of like what happened with the lottery. And I think that the voters need to know that. So yes, it will eventually get to the roads, but it's they felt like they had a better chance of getting this passed if they used the highway patrol to kind of tug on the heartstrings of people, maybe vote for it. I hope that it passes. Generally, these taxes pass in outstate Missouri, but won't pass in the urban area. So hopefully they will see the need to support this. We all drive on our roads. We all know that we have to do something. This is one step in the right direction.
We're getting quite a stack of questions from the audience, which is exciting. So these will obviously be questions that our candidates have not seen before. This next one gets us back into the rotation of 1, 2, 3. So Representative Shoemaker will take this first. The question is, each of you signed a petition to begin impeachment proceedings against Governor Greitens or even call for his resignation. Could you explain the reasoning behind your decision regarding the impeachment proceedings?
Yeah, at the time that resolution came forward, we were very concerned that the whole process of state government might shut down. The Senate is kind of known for that, what they did in the past years, and we wanted to see our priorities go through. A signature on that petition did not mean that we wanted to impeach the governor necessarily, but what we did agree to, those of us who signed it, and I did, not because I wanted to impeach the governor, but because I wanted to see the process of the regular session get through to its end, and then let's deal with this in a special election. And that's what's happened. I regret what happened to the governor. I still don't feel good about it at all. A number of us went up into his office after he made his announcement and actually prayed with him and showed him some support on the personal side, which I think was necessary to do. I still don't feel good about how it happened. I was concerned that the process didn't really square with what I read in the Constitution about the impeachment clause, and the more we found out about it, the worse I felt about the situation. But his resignation did save us, the vote, and I think we were able to go on as a state as a result.
Representative Redmond.
I also signed this petition, but I signed it just for the opposite reason of impeachment. I signed it because I felt like the process was moving too fast. It was getting ahead of the criminal side of it, and I wanted it to slow down. The same day that I signed it, I had a meeting with Governor Greitens and told him what I did and why, and he was fine with that. I felt like we needed to hear more about the criminal proceedings before we went forward with the impeachment proceedings. When we started that process, I felt like it was we had a committee that was out there to find facts and get those facts reported back to the body. As the process went along, it seemed like we kind of lost our mark, and it wasn't if we were going to impeach the governor, but more when. And I had a lot of issues and angst with that. So I very readily signed that, not to impeach the governor, but to give the process a chance to work. If the process would have came back and the facts would have been there, I would have done my duty and impeached the governor. But I wanted everything, I wanted everyone to have their due in court and due process. And that's why I signed it.
And finally on impeachment, Representative Maple.
Well, I was one of the first to support Eric Greitens when he decided to run for governor, but I was also one of the first to call for his resignation. I called for it in January of 16. I knew after visiting with investigators and also having visited with the governor on several occasions that I knew that he had some very serious violations to the Constitution. And I was not one of the first to sign his impeachment because I really wanted to see the whole process take place. He told me, or his people, his team told me, that I'd be dead before he would resign. He resigned. I'm still alive. I was threatened several times. But the situation is, this governor violated the Constitution, and he didn't take it seriously. We are to represent and to honor our title and not have the title honor us, and he never took it seriously. And it was his choice to resign. But he will probably be in prison probably within the next few months. So that's the way I looked at it. I didn't sign the impeachment thing, cross my name out, and then sign it again. I signed it, and I called for his resignation. If he'd resigned back in January, I think his life would have been better now. Thank you.
Representative Shoemaker.
Okay, these two questions from the audience, I hope the audience members won't mind that I combine them because I think you might be able to handle them both together. And with this one, we'll start with Representative Redmond, followed by Walker, and then Shoemaker. Do you think there are any instances in which abortion should be permitted? And where do you stand on euthanasia, so-called mercy killing?
One, I don't think there's any instances that abortion is acceptable. And two, there's no instance for euthanasia to be acceptable either. A life is a life, and that's pretty simple, and that's my stance on it.
Representative Walker.
I'm pro-life, I oppose abortion, and I oppose euthanasia, and I think God has a will and a plan for all of us, and we need to let that plan take place. Thank you.
And I'm also pro-life, too, and there's such a thing as a tubal pregnancy where, you know, they would call it abortion, I suppose, to where it wouldn't be a viable, you know, the baby wouldn't be viable. But I'm against abortion flat out, you know. I believe it's a life, and I believe it's a life at the other end also, too. So I disagree with a lot of abortion. I hope Roe versus Wade goes down, and we can start having a culture of life rather than a culture of death in our society. And I don't believe in mercy killing.
Thank you all. And thanks again to the audience for offering these questions. We're going to move on now to some rankings that are not necessarily something to brag about. And I'm going to have to read this one off the screen just like you are. Missouri is 45th out of 50 states with the worst scores regarding low incarceration rate, sexual violence in prisons, we're at 43rd out of 50, on juvenile incarcerations, we're 38, public safety, we're 36th out of 50 for low property crime rate and 43rd out of 50 for low violent crime. So the question, what type of legislation might you suggest in the Senate to change these numbers? And with this one, we will start with Representative Walker. I know that's a very long lead-in to this question, so.
Well, I don't know if there's any perfect legislation to address that, but we have to get up each and every day and try to address these issues and make sure that Missouri starts moving towards the top and being first in things rather than last in things. And I think, you know, we have some serious problems in our urban areas. In our rural areas, crime is coming out here because some of the urban people are moving out here. But crime is a terrible situation, so we have to make sure that we have law enforcement support for them. Education is important, and so I think we just have to look at a lot of different things and look towards putting the money in our budget towards the right areas to change this. But certainly there are a lot of issues that Missouri needs to address, and I look forward to working towards that with other legislators. And I know that that's not a real definite solution to these things, but I do recognize these problems, and I think we have to become number one in more things and not go the other way. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Shoemaker.
This is certainly not one of those things that we want to be number one in. And I'm a volunteer in corrections. I've been a volunteer in corrections since 1976. I did so before being state representative, and I continue being a volunteer in corrections to this day. As recently as last night, I was face-to-face with prisoners in our prison system. And what can we do to solve the situation of crime? I think a lot of the problem is family dynamics. I've concluded over the years that we've got to do whatever we can do to encourage whole two-parent families. There's very little society can do. Well, there's a lot we can do, but really can't make up for the fact that there's a parent missing in one-parent families. So whatever our policies are, whether it be welfare policies or policies concerning marriage and divorce, I think we have to look at that situation too. Values descend from religion also. And people are getting away from spiritual values. I find people are more afraid to go into the public school with their faith than they are to go into the prison with their faith. And that's a problem right there. We have to get back to those values. And I think that's what's the big problem.
Finally, on these rankings, we have Representative Graham.
I think there's a direct correlation between education and prison and lack of education. And I'm not going to say it's the school's issue. I'm thinking that there needs to be more collaboration, more communication between social entities that go out and call on these families and getting them help early on. A lot of times in government, we work in silos, where this silo goes out and does one thing, but they fail to communicate that there's an issue that these kids can't read, or there's no books in their house, and there's not any parental discretion there to help these children. So the first thing I think we need to do is increase the communication between departments. We need to look at, once these kids become trouble in society, what remedies are we using? Are we sticking them in prison or in juvenile centers that just make them worse criminals? Are we giving them any kind of training while they're there or when they first get out so that the recidivism rate isn't as great? We've got to look at it more than just punishment. It's got to be giving them opportunities to succeed. A lot of times we're quick to slap them on the wrist, but then we don't tell them how to straighten their lives out. And I think we need to start looking at a more holistic approach to these people in these areas and try to figure it out. It's not going to be easy. It's generational. And we've got to stop that downward spiral.
Thank you to all three of you on that one. We have one more question that is specific to rankings, and it has to do with health care. According to U.S. News and World Report, Missouri ranks 39th out of 50 states in health care. Starting with Representative Shumate, what type of legislation might you suggest in the Senate to improve the health care standings of the state of Missouri?
One thing that we can do right away, and we have done to some extent, is to deal with the healthcare professionals out here in the rural area. And we've done some things by tweaking the laws pertaining to advanced practical registered nurses. And this would be a very important thing we've done things like making the distance between them and their collaborative doctor further, telehealth care, and so forth. Broadband could help tremendously in the delivery of health services out in the rural areas. And I believe that I'm also a chaplain at the hospital. I can see health care going on with the patients that are there and so forth. And I think it's not the health care itself so much as it's the financing of health care and the delivery of health care, getting where it's needed. And if we can, I sure would love to see that Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, otherwise known as Obamacare, out, because that's created a tremendous problem, a boondoggle in the healthcare system. If insurance could be brought, could be purchased across state lines, if there could be other innovative ways of financing, I think it would be very helpful for the delivery of health care, especially in the rural areas.
Thank you, Representative Brittman.
I agree with Representative Shumate on the nurse practitioners. I actually have carried a couple of bills for nurse practitioners over the last few years and was honored that they gave me an award as Legislator of the Year for carrying some of this legislation. I think we have to deal with reality out here in the rural area. You can't go to medical school and come out here and be able to go and pay your educational bill that you've accumulated. So I think we'll have to rely on nurse practitioners. And with the advancements in telemedicine and other areas, I think that's a reality that we can look at. You know, we've looked at programs where we've tried to help pay for people to go to college and become doctors and then come out and have to serve so long. And it just hasn't worked out, so I think we have to refocus. I also agree with the Obamacare situation. All that's done is drive companies out of the insurance business, driving up costs. So it's another one of those government not easy questions, but it's something that we have to keep tackling and nibbling at the apple every day, and hopefully eventually we'll get it under control. But I do feel like that the nurse practitioner is one of the things that we can do in the here and now that will help our healthcare system.
Representative Ball.
The Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare, has been very disappointing. It's been a failure. I don't know why the majority of Congress doesn't do away with it, but it needs to be totally done away with. We need to work towards making sure that we do have some sort of affordable health care, but the Obamacare bill did not do it. Here in the rural areas, we have to make sure that we support our nurse practitioners, to make sure that we have physicians and dentists and other health providers throughout Northeast Missouri. I have a unique experience because I represent a medical school, A.T. Still University, and also represent a dental school there in Kirksville. And our nurse practitioners are probably one of the greatest assets we have in the state of Missouri. I supported their expansion of service areas and that sort of thing, and so I think we have to make sure that we have programs there that make our opportunities here in the rural areas to get doctors here, dentists here, and nurse practitioners are a great part of it. Thank you very much.
We have another question coming that I haven't looked at yet, but a question from the audience: do you support Common Core? We talked a lot about education at the beginning of this, and now we have another question about education, and that is, do you support Common Core? For the benefit of the audience, my recollection was that in the Obama administration, there was race to the top at the Department of Education in Washington. This comes from about 2010, an effort of the National Governors Association and others to try to bring some consistency to what students know at the end of a school year. It's been obviously somewhat controversial. So on this one, we will begin with Representative Redmond. And the question from the audience, do you support Common Core?
I don't support Common Core. And 3 years ago when John Deal was the Speaker of the House, he called the Common Core people in to a committee hearing room. He called the education people into a committee hearing room. And we worked it out right then. We did away with Common Core, and we have what we call the Missouri Standard. Now, you have to have standards in order to qualify for some federal dollars. And at that time, we had to maintain most of the standards that were in Common Core, but we changed a lot of the things, and this is strictly from my recollection, but I'm pretty sure I'm right on this. We expanded the board to include legislators and education people, just general public, and teachers, and there might have been another group, but Common Core was done away with at that time, and it was replaced with the Missouri Standard.
Again, Representative Walker.
I ran for the legislature to do away with Common Core. It's gone in the state of Missouri. We have the Missouri Standards, which is fine. I've met with school administrators throughout my district, throughout Northeast Missouri, and with their input, we have a standard to work off of for education, for public education. I think it's important that we don't just fall for tricks that come out of Washington, D.C., whether it's Republican tricks or Democrat tricks. The best education is home. is home delivered in our own school districts with local school boards and that sort of thing, because it's just important that each state handles their own things. But I oppose Common Core and I'm glad it's gone. Thank you.
And finally, Representative Schoening.
I also oppose Common Core. My biggest concern about Common Core was that it was kind of a backdoor way of nationalizing education. It came through the National Governors Conference, the way I understand, and it came about to the states, kind of past all of the watchful eyes of the legislators and the parents and everybody. And next thing we know, it's there, and how did it get here, you know? And then when I looked at some of the problems and the way that Common Core was, it seemed like it practically was more confusing for students than the way that we learn things, such as math. We don't need a national model. I mean, I believe that education should be from the bottom up, basically to meet these local needs and the needs that the students are anticipated to have throughout life. And a national model. The other thing I was really concerned about Common Core is it didn't just involve math and reading, it would also involve things like social studies and so forth. And I was afraid that a lot of lessons might come over that computer and outside of the watchful eye of parents. I believe that our biggest guard against things that should not come is parents, parental involvement, and family involvement in education.
Thank you all very much. And again, thanks to our audience for coming up with these questions. We have two more in front of us right now from that. Are you hanging with us okay? I know we're an hour and a half into this, but we've got two more questions from the audience here. We will do this one in the order of Representative Walker, followed by Representative Shoemake, and then Representative Redmond. The question from an audience member is, the number of children in foster care are growing rapidly due to substance abuse, mental health. Hannibal has record numbers. Foster homes are in dire need. What are your plans to help these high-risk children? And if you don't mind, this next question was also about mental health. And this is so much in the headlines the last week or so. Mental health issues create many problems. How would you try to improve mental health services? So we have two questions that are related to mental health. So we may give them a little break on the minute and a half and, you know, give them 2 minutes so that they can try to capture both of these mental health issues. Substance abuse, mental health, increased record numbers in foster homes. How do we deal with high-risk children and improve mental health services?
Okay. This is probably one of the toughest questions that we could have. It's probably one of the most important questions that we could have, because mental health and everything wraps around mental health. And we're all a product of mental health to a point. And so we have to make sure that we have programs in place so that when people have mental health issues or substance abuse issues, they can get treated. And then the result, oftentimes, of mental health or substance abuse is a result of children having to go into foster care. And those parents or those families that are foster care families, you've got to give them a special place in God's hands. Just recently, you may have read this in the newspaper, but down in Camden County, there was a house or a trailer house that burned. Four or five little children were killed in a fire. First of all, there were no smoke alarms in this trailer, but when you talk to law enforcement, when you talk to people down there, and I talked to the representative who represents that area, you find out that it was basically substance abuse, not only by the parents, but also by the little caregiver that was there to watch these children. So we've got to do everything we possibly can to work with law enforcement and other groups to make sure that we have strong mental health programs. Here in Northeast Missouri, we have Preferred Family Health Care. We have Mark Twain Behavioral Health Care that do a lot of things good for mental health issues. But foster care needs to continue to be a priority. Mrs. Greitens was working really hard on that, and I hope that Mrs. Parson will take over that also. But anyway, those are terrible issues, and I'll do everything I possibly can to support and work towards mental health and foster care to help our young people.
Thank you. Representative Schumann.
Yes.
You're ahead of me.
I agree, this is probably one of the most difficult questions of the night, because you have these children in foster care that have to be taken care of. How do you find and recruit good foster families? I think the best source is the churches, our religious institutions, the people that have values that will do this out of the goodness of their heart, because certainly the foster care payment is not going to be the incentive in this case. It's just going to have to be people that will do this because they want to do it, because they've got love in their hearts for these children. And the reason they got there, the mental health problems have been proliferating in our communities. I think a lot of it is a result of drugs, a lot of it is a result of those broken families. It seems like if one has a satisfying experience in their whole complete family, the chances of mental health issues developing are probably less. I think we could do a lot towards preventing war if we just build up that nuclear family, one man, one woman carrying on their responsibilities. Another thing too, it might help. Sometimes people that have their mental problems, are some of their problems are that they don't feel like they're useful. Well, there's plenty of jobs out there to have. And there's some folks that may be having problems with their thinking. One thing, if they just go to work. Surprise how good therapy, a good job and responsibility can mean to these folks. And I hope we can get them a lot of them employed, and that alone can help a lot of those things happen.
One of the things I've learned in my time sitting on the budget committee is the sooner you can get money to a problem like mental health, the earlier you can catch it in the process, the better your results are, and actually the less money you're going to spend in the long run. The problem is finding that money to put up front. There's so many needs out there in the state, but it's been proven that if you can get someone early on that needs access to mental health, it's going to save them, because they're not going to get in trouble with the police, they're not going to have all the criminal charges, we're not going to have to incarcerate them, so on and so forth. And you won't have the children in foster care. I had the opportunity to visit a foster home a couple months ago. Those people are phenomenal. They're beyond belief. They were sitting there so patient with those kids. Those kids needed love so bad. And those people are actually out recruiting other parents to be foster parents. And Lendl's right, and Nate's right. The money they get for doing it doesn't near cover what they need to spend for those kids. So my hat's off to them. I think our challenge as a state is finding that money, that upfront money, that money that we can invest early on in the process on these people, so that we can concur this behavior and hopefully help these people and help these children.
Thank you. We were given two questions, and then this will be the final questions unless something shows up that I don't know about yet. Two questions about housing and historic preservation. I think the first one probably doesn't need to be asked, but just for the benefit of the audience, all of you voted this last legislative session to support the First Time Homebuyer Savings Account Act. And for the benefit of the audience, one of the toughest things for a first-time homebuyer to get over, the biggest hurdle, is the down payment. And so oftentimes you will hear about tax-deferred savings in different ways. And the legislature, very recently, the House and the Senate, passed a new bill that will allow parents and grandparents to put aside money tax-free to help a young couple or single buyer save for a down payment. So I don't think we need to ask that question.
I think it's been answered because you all supported it. But more importantly, historically rich structures. You have many historic structures in this Senate district, Senate District 18, yet one of the main ways to renovate these, one of the big incentives to renovate these historic buildings has been cut. How would you structure the historic tax credits to be budget conscious yet still maintain availability to all communities? And this one first goes to Representative Schumann. We're back to 1, 2, 3 for the final question. So the question is about historic tax credits, and they were cut recently, but how would you structure those tax credits to be budget conscious but still available to those that need them?
I'm from Hannibal, Missouri. A lot of history in Hannibal, Missouri, a lot of historic buildings. I've seen the positive result of the use of credits and historic credits. We have an old hospital building that the city is desperately wanting to see advanced, or waiting for a decision from the Missouri Housing and Development Commission about that. If we look at construction, we look at buildings like this, and you could go to Chicago or places that have low-income housing that are completely financed by the government, and you see them in disrepair and becoming a slum after a while. But then again, you see other projects that have skin, you would say, by those that are working to build it, and such as the tax credit programs. And these ones where there are partnerships and proverbial skin in the game by both those that want the project to happen and those that are doing the project seem to turn out better than just the complete federal government model that we've seen fail so many years ago.
Thank you, Representative Redmond.
Well, tax credits in Jefferson City right now kind of have a black eye, so whether it's a really good tax credit or a really bad tax credit, it's gonna fall under that umbrella of being bad right now. That's the way it's viewed. The first 4 years that I was in Jefferson City, I served on the Economic Development Committee, so I saw a lot of good programs come through, and I tried to pick out what the good parts of those programs were and how they could best be administered. Some of the things that I picked up on, one is you need to have a third party that certifies that the money's going to the project and the money's being spent and your return on investment is happening. The other is you need to have a different entity that actually administers this. It doesn't have anything to do with the results, but that makes the people wanting those go through a checklist. I think 25% minimum needs to be designated for outstate Missouri. If it's not, then the urban areas will gobble up all these historic tax credits and we won't be able to use them. Another thing, they need to be where they can't be sold, used as currency for entity that wants to get involved in this and make money off of that. And the last and most important thing about a tax credit program, it needs to have a sunset. Everything in Jefferson City needs to have a sunset. I'm firmly convinced of that, because if you don't, it will go on and it will spiral out of control. So if it has a drop dead date and you have to vote on it again, you have to relook at it, I think we'd be better off as a state.
Thank you. Finally, Representative Walker, on our last. I see a question coming. Representative Walker.
Well, I think the tax credit system needs to be reformed. I've served on the Policy Development Caucus. That was a special group of legislators from throughout the state. I was actually one of the only legislators that served on it up from the river in northern Missouri. But I support benevolent tax credits. I think both Craig and I and Linda both have supported the legislation this year to expand that. I do think there needs to be sunset on our tax credits, but I do know the benefits of the historic tax credits. I've seen the benefits at Moberly, I've seen them in Macon, I've seen them in Kirksville, I've seen them in Hannibal. I've seen them throughout the 18th district, down in Louisiana, Missouri, and places like that. And so in rural Missouri, I think the historic tax credits are very important, and we need to maybe look at reform on some of the others. And when you get into San Luis City, you see that Josh Hawley, the Attorney General, is now making a very major investigation of Mr. McKee's tax scam that he's got going on there, and that's a lot of money that he collected, millions and millions of dollars. But the historic tax credits are really good for rural Missouri, particularly the 18th district. Thank you.
Thank you. So this question from the audience will begin with Representative Redmond. Do you think Missouri needs an adoption conscious protection act to protect faith-based adoption agencies from being forced to violate their consciences and religious liberties?
That's pretty deep.
Do you think Missouri needs an adoption conscious protection act to protect faith-based adoption agencies from being forced to violate their consciences and religious liberties?
I don't feel like anyone should be forced to violate their religious beliefs. I'm not sure, without checking, that we could do something constitutionally. I would be in favor. This is a deep question. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to absorb a little bit. You know, everyone has their right to believe what they believe, and everyone should be allowed to do that as long as it is not infringing on someone else's rights. So based on that, I feel like, yes, they should be protected and not be forced to do something that would be against their religious belief. I'm sorry, I'm trying to...
You can leave that there for... Representative Walker will be next.
Well, I support the Bill of Rights, and I support the Constitution and the freedom of religion. I'm an elder in the First Christian Church in Kirksville. I'm a wedding officiant. I choose who I want to marry, and when people ask me to marry them, I sit down with them and talk with them, and if I'm the right officiant for them, then I marry them. But I think we need to respect all people's rights of religion, and I'm a Christian, and I believe that if we need to look into this, but I don't know specifics of it, I don't know if it's a trick question or whatever, but I will do everything I possibly can to protect people's freedom of religion and to do things that are positive to protect our religious rights. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Representative Shoemaker.
Yeah, I believe I understand the background of this question. Over in Illinois, because of certain things that they had required of adoption agencies, they practically run Catholic charities, I think, out of the state. And it's usually liberal things like, you've got to be able, if you're an agency, that you would have to place that child. If you're a private adoption agency, you can't, do it unless you agree to, say, place those children in a same-sex relationship. And this is the reason why some religious agencies, and particularly our next-door neighbor over here, have been practically can't even operate there anymore. As I know, it's not quite the situation here in Missouri. We don't have that situation here in Missouri necessarily, but I think we have to be vigilant to see that something like this doesn't crop up. I think the best source of adoptive agencies are those faith-based agencies. I think that we get the most for our investment as a state or anyway by using them. We would have an interest in it because they have an interest in the people. For example, our foster homes, and it would be no different with this.
And then finally, Representative Redmond. Oh, no, we've covered that. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm
We have one final question from the audience. Can you stand it? One final question, and then we're finished. This is a great question from a young member of the audience, I believe. In your eyes, what do you think the current state of political culture is? How do you think, or what could you do to help the next generation to step up and become interested? First, we'll be back to the 1-2-3 order, and so Representative Shoemake. This is a young member of the audience asking, what in your eyes, how do you see the current political culture, and what do you think we can do to help the next generation become more involved?
I think both my colleagues would agree that we know the people, we get to know the people personally that we work with, and by and large, we work with some very good people that are there for the right reasons. But also, in my short time there, I have seen people come and destroy lives and destroy their own lives through bad decisions. It's better for one not to be in public office than to go down there and use whatever adulation that they get or whatever and see it, their home come apart as a result. I believe we want to encourage the generation that's coming to do this for the right reason, for, in fact, public service. And it requires a level of maturity in order to do that, because when people get elected to something, and here you are in a position of responsibility, you have to realize I'm the same person. I'm the same person that I came down here. You know, I haven't changed. And those values that are brought, a person should have a good understanding of themselves and their own values, and use all the opportunities they have, such as internships, to find out about it and to learn it to. Decide that's what they're
going to do. Yeah, in your eyes, tell us your opinion of the current state of the political climate culture, and how do you think, or what could you do to help get this next generation to step up and become more involved in politics? And
right now, I see the climate is very attacking mode. If Republicans are in power, then the Democrats are going to attack in any manner they can, just to disrupt things and vice versa. But when you actually get down to Jefferson City, that culture is not quite there. I mean, I actually have some really good Democratic friends. We actually agree on a ton of different things. I think a lot of that culture and what you see is created by the media. There's a lot of good people, like Linda said, that are down there for the right reasons. If you're going to get involved, don't get involved because you think you're going to be promoted to some star status or your phone's going to ring off the wall with thank yous or anything like that. You need to be involved because you want to make your area and your community better. And if you go down there with that, with the server's heart in mind, you'll probably be successful. It doesn't matter how many bills you pass, but it matters if you've represented your constituents in a manner that you can be proud of. So I would encourage the young people to get involved. I love it when I get to talk to school groups or just young people on the street and tell them, you know, things aren't like what you see on the television down there. We actually get stuff done, and there's actually cooperation that goes along. So please get out there if you're interested. Talk to me, talk to one of my colleagues. We'd love to get the young people involved and get them out there so that the next generation's ready. Because I already know you guys are a lot smarter than we are.
Thank you, finally, Representative Walker, on this final question from the audience.
Well, I was blessed to be born into a family that believes in public service. I was encouraged as a young child to be involved in public service. And my mother taught me the golden rule, and I was given the opportunity to have a conscience. Now, when you say all those things, you think, well, what's that got to do with it? But in the General Assembly, I think, first of all, we have good public servants throughout. There are members of the General Assembly that never vote the same way that I do, or never vote the same way as Lyndall or Craig. We probably vote together about 97-98% of the time together. And the times we don't vote together, it's really small differences. But I think it's important to have a spirit and a heart of giving and public service. And I was just fortunate to have this opportunity to serve twice in the General Assembly, once when I was a young person, 26 years old, and now as an old person. And I would encourage anybody, whatever their age is, to be a public servant. You don't have to be elective office, but go out and give to each other's needs and help other people in your community. And I'm blessed, and I look forward to serving the 18th District as the next state senator. And I'll put that past experience to work for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and thanks to the audience for the amazing questions. So our final job here will be to let each of them give just a 2-minute closing statement, and then we'll be out of here. So we'll give you your, since we started with Representative Shoemake, we'll now go to Representative Redmond to do the closing remarks. And so you've got 2 minutes to say any final remarks you'd like to say to our audience, who stood with us for an hour and 45 minutes.
Yeah, I think
almost 2 hours.
Give them a round of applause.
Yeah, we'll do that.
I appreciate it. Well, I do want to thank you guys for having this forum. It's been good. I also want to tell everybody that things in Jefferson City were good this year. You know, everybody was so focused in on the headlines and the governor's issues and things like that. The legislative body has had record years. We passed historic legislation. You can ask anybody down there. The most conservative, business-friendly legislation was passed this session. We passed, I think, around 170 bills. Last year, we passed around 7. So we kept our focus. We did what we were supposed to. I felt like we produced a tremendous budget. Like I said, we fully funded the formula for the second year in a row. Never happened before. A lot of the things that we have put into place over the last few years, not just this year, are starting to pay off in Missouri. For the first time in our history, we've outperformed economically all the eight states surrounding us. That's never happened. We have the lowest unemployment rate we've ever had in the state so far. We are doing things right. More businesses are wanting to locate and expand. Businesses now have plenty of work. The problem is finding the workers and keeping the workers. That's a great problem to have. We have Missouri moving in the right direction. We need to keep going with this. We need to keep limiting regulations, keep lowering taxes, keep being business friendly, because as our economy improves, so will everything else that goes along with it. Roads, education, healthcare. So thank you for your time this evening. I appreciate you guys sitting there all that time. I know my seat was getting a little sore, so yours must really be. But thank you very much.
Thank you, Representative Walker. Your closing statement.
First of all, I want to thank the Mark Twain Association of Realtors for inviting us here. And I think we were notified like 2 or 3 months ago to be here. And I know that Craig and Lyndall and I had 2 other options to do today that we could have done. One was to play softball or baseball against Illinois, and that would have been a lot of fun, but we had a responsibility to be here to the voters of the 18th District, so I'm glad you all chose the same path that I did. It's indeed a pleasure to be here and be a part of this forum. I look forward to participating in additional forums in Moberly and Kirksville and in Macon and wherever else that they want to have. But as I said earlier, if you're not going to be in the arena each and every day, you don't need to be involved in a race for the 18th District Senate. It's been a pleasure and an honor to serve. I show up every day in the Missouri General Assembly, and I don't miss votes, and I consider it an honor, and I try to do every day to honor the title that I represent, not have it honor me. And public service is not easy, and it's not simple. And in many ways, it's a form of life that is sometimes dangerous. But I've been honored and privileged to serve as the 3rd District State Representative and serve Northeast Missouri in the legislature for 10 years. I look forward to that opportunity in the Senate. If I'm not elected to the Senate, my life will go on, and God will have another plan for me. But I think I'm going to win, so thank you.
Finally, Representative Schumann.
I'd also like to thank the Mark Twain Association of Realtors for sponsoring this event here tonight, and all the audience that came out and bore with us all this time. And I'm sure you found it better than whatever else was on TV here tonight. I hope that's your case. But it has been one of the greatest honors of my life to serve as 5th District State Representative. And I'm looking forward to greater and even more service in serving. And unique things that we all bring our unique life experiences when it comes to our service in the Capitol. And even with that, with all of the life experiences I had beforehand, I found it to be a tremendous learning experience, especially the freshman year. It was like drinking from a fire hose. But I was able to bring everything that I've learned in life to bear upon my office of state representative. I'm the only veteran in the race. I'm a veteran. I served in Vietnam, and I have a sensitivity towards veterans' issues, but that's not the only thing. There are other issues concerned about also as well. We want to leave our state better than it was when we came. We want to prepare for the next generation so that those that are coming after us will have a framework. And we want to preserve our democracy also. I serve on the as chair of the Elections and Elected Officials Committee, and one thing I don't want to see happen is a national popular vote. That's not the way the Founding Fathers had a good reason for it the way that it is, and I believe it needs to stay that way. And that comes up. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. On behalf of the Mark Twain Association of Realtors and the Northeast Central Association of Realtors, we appreciate all the time you gave tonight. To the audience, all of you, and to those who watched on the live stream, thank you so much. How about a big round of applause for the team?